And another opportunity for you and I to gather around the good word of God. We are blessed with faithful Abraham. Welcome to part four in our series, Footsteps of Faith. Thank you for coming along. For those of you that watch us by YouTube, thank you so much. We appreciate you. We're going to ask you to like, subscribe, click the bell, and to share with others the teachings of connections. Good morning, Sister Brianna. Right there within the first few seconds of being online, this lady is hooked in the word with us. We're so blessed with you, Sister Brianna. Thank you for coming and being a part day after day, week after week. You are an encouragement to me. Thank you so very much. Father, in Jesus' name, we're so thrilled about Jesus. We're thrilled about the Word and the Spirit of God. Thank you for what you've done for us, what you're doing in us and through us. Father, we declare the blessing of Abraham is upon this broadcast today. Thank you for rich insight into your Word today. Father, we choose to have ears to hear. And eyes to see and a heart that's open, ready and receptive. Thank you, Father, for this anointed time. Thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for utterance by the Holy Ghost and deposits of grace in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Good morning, Brother William. Good morning, Brother Rex. Appreciate you gentlemen being with me today. Most people that have watched have never said hi. Come on now. Come on. You've been watching us for years and you haven't said hi. Let us know who you are and where you're watching from. Even if you don't catch us live, you catch us at another time, that's okay. We go back and check the numbers and check and see the comments. Please let us know who you are, where you're watching from. That would be a blessing to us. We are trying to reach as many people as we can with the good news of Jesus and our covenant with Almighty God because of what he's done for us. So let us know who you are, please. All right, we're going to jump right into the word this morning. Let's go to Romans chapter 4. We'll read verse 12, and we'll get into these footsteps of faith that Abraham laid out for us. There's Sister Lottie. Good morning. Praise the Lord. Thank you for being with us, Sister Lottie. Awesome. Romans chapter 4, verse 12, the Bible says, speaking of Abraham, of course, and the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. When we are born again, we've made Jesus Christ the Lord of our lives. We begin to walk this walk of faith. The Bible tells us that Abraham is our father in the faith. He laid out a track for us to follow. The Bible exalts Abraham above all others as far as human beings. Obviously, Jesus is the greatest. But as far as humans, Abraham is exalted above all the others. God tagged him with the title of Father of our faith. Abraham went from promise to fulfillment. And because he was successful at receiving, God says, if you will follow this pattern of believing, you also will go from promise to fulfillment. Good morning there, Brother David. Thank you for being with us today. As we look at the steps of the faith that Abraham took, so in order for him to become, I don't want you to be discouraged with the progress that you're making. I know that there are times that it seems like our progress is very slow. Sometimes it seems like we make two steps forward and take three steps back. I personally feel like my development has been extremely slow. I know others would look at me and disagree with me. They would disagree with that statement. But from my perspective, I feel like my development in the things of the Lord has been very slow. And so don't be discouraged in that, okay? If God got us to where we're at now, he's not going to drop us. He's not going to leave you. He's not going to leave you hanging. He will take you in to your promised land. He'll bring you into fulfillment if we will just stay with him. So don't get discouraged. Don't quit. All right. Just stay with the Lord. I mean, if it takes you 90 extra days, what are you going to do in the next 90 days, right? You're going to be believing God. You're going to stay faithful. You're going to stay after it. And then if it just takes an extra 90 days, so what? You know, you're still going to be walking with the Lord. You're going to be fellowshipping with him. You're going to be loving him and growing and developing. So, you know, it's not that big of a deal. Just stay with it. I'm reminded, the Spirit of the Lord said to me one time, he said, that there's something greater than great faith, and that is consistent faith. If you'll just stay consistent, don't worry about having great faith. Just get up and live by faith every single day, you will get there. So the first step that Abraham took is in verse 18. It says, who against hope believed in hope. So we shorten that down to in hope against hope. The first step that Abraham took was hope. And we saw that hope is a blueprint. It's an inner image. And this first step we spent the last 3 days on, it's imperative we understand the power of our imagination. I'm not going to go through everything again. I want us to get to the second step, but I want us to see a connection here. When you see, this is something I heard from a person, and it stayed with me the very first time I heard it. This can become a cliche, but it needs to be examined, and it goes like this. When you see the invisible, you can do the impossible. Good morning there, Brother William. When you see the invisible, you can do the impossible. I think that merits some meditation, that merits some thought, some study. That's a title of one of Oral Roberts' last books that he ever wrote before he passed away. If you see the invisible, you can do the impossible. If we replay the pictures of our past experiences, that will limit us from the future blessing that God wants to get into our lives. Now, I'm going to set you up for what I believe to be a wonderful and an exciting truth here. Let me say this again. If we replay the pictures of our past experiences, that will limit us from the future blessing that God wants to get into our lives. Your past experience is not the prophecy of your future. Boy, somebody really needs to hear that today and be encouraged. Your past experience is not the prophecy of your future. Our God is a God of hope, and He wants us to abound in hope. Good morning, Sister Lisa. He wants us to abound in hope. So the first step was in hope, he believed against hope. He took hope, he took a blueprint from what God said, and he rejected natural hope, he rejected wishing, and he didn't look to circumstances to encourage him. That's the first step. The second step is this, that he believed. It says here in verse 18, who against hope believed in hope. Good morning, Sister Elizabeth. First step, he's a man of hope. Second step, he is a man of faith. He believed. He believed. I need to shift gears and go slower because of what we're going to get into today. And if we're not careful, we can just let this zoom by us and we really don't understand the importance of this second step, that he believed. Abraham had faith as a result of the hope that he received from God's word. He had no evidence other than God's word. Faith is not ambiguous. You have got to believe. You must have faith. That would be obvious, since these are the footsteps of faith. Somewhere you've got to take the step where you say, I now believe, I have faith. I hesitate to say this because I understand that most of you are not preachers. You don't get paid to pray and study. You've got to get a job. You've got responsibilities. I understand that. But I still believe that this applies to you. You must be consumed with the things of God in order to be good at it. You must be consumed with the things of God in order to be good at it. Now, throughout my lifetime, there's times I've had to work a secular job, but by the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, I found ways to still be employed in ministry, employed in serving God, even while at Loaf and Jug or driving a forklift at Kraft Foods or whatever I was doing. I knew it was a bridge to get me to where I was going, and you can still find ways with the help of the Holy Spirit to be employed in the things of God, even if you have to be employed in the natural. So Abraham, he believed. He believed. Everybody say, Abraham believed. One more time. Abraham, he believed. Now, I want you to see something here with me. Look at verse 16 and 17. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace to the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, that's you and I, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. Now, if you look at verse 17, the very first part of verse 17 is a parenthetical statement. The parenthetical statement is, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations. For illustration purposes, for teaching purposes, I want us to read verse 16 and 17. I want to skip the parenthetical statement for a moment. Good morning, Brother Rex. Okay, so if you have your Bible, follow along with me. If you don't, go back later and check it out. Let's skip the parenthetical statement for a second for teaching purposes. Therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead, and calleth those things that be not as though they were, who against hope believed in hope that he might become. The second step that Abraham took was faith. In this Romans 4, verse 16 and 17 tells us of the second step before the first step. There is a reason for this. There is a reason why he did introduce hope first and then faith. He introduced faith first. He gives us the second step. Then he goes back to the first step. Then he talks about the second step again, who against hope believed. Why all this? What's going on here? And I like to dig around. I like to dissect and take it apart and figure out what's going on. What all is God saying? So go, check this out. Romans 4, he gives the second step first. Then he goes back to the first step. Then he goes back to the second step and saying he believed. What is happening here? There is something about God and the way he deals with you and I. And we find this pattern with God and Abraham. We're going to go, please, to Genesis 15. This is going to answer some questions for you right here. Some of you have asked this question for years, and I really believe you're going to get your answer right here. Good morning, Sister Christina. Brother Christian and I, we have talked about this many times. And I really believe that this is an answer. Once again, if we can discover God's pattern of dealing with people, see that same pattern in us, it gives us comfort. It gives us encouragement. I really am a child of God. I really am a saint. God's working in me the same thing he worked in all these other Bible heroes. He's doing the same thing. And if we can discover the pattern, God can find us easier to work with. All right? So I want God to find me easy to work with. So let's find the patterns. So here in Genesis 15, watch how God works. Watch the pattern, and then you'll see it in your life as well. This is going to be an answer. This is going to put a smile on your face. Going to make you happy this morning. Full of joy. Genesis 15, and look at verse 5. Genesis 15, 5. He brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven, and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. Hope. There it is. There's the blueprint. There's the picture. Okay, hope. Verse 6, and he believed in the Lord. There it is. There's the second step. There's faith. Step one, hope. Step two, he believed, right? God gave picture. God spoke. He saw it. He saw the picture. And in hope, he believed. Now, when the Bible says in Romans 4 that in hope he believed against hope, what does that mean? Does that mean in a state of hope he believed? Or does that mean that Abraham had faith in the power of hope? It means both. But push comes to shove, the first application is that in the state of hope he took the next step and he believed. He says, look at the stars, count them, so shall thy seed be. Step two, he believed in the Lord and he counted it to him for righteousness. Verse 7, look for the pattern. He said unto him, I am the Lord that brought thee out of Ur of the Chaldees to give thee this land to inherit it. And he said, Lord God, whereby shall I know that I shall inherit it? What do we have? We have hope. First, we have faith. Second, and now God introduces another promise. God's first promise to Abraham is posterity. You're going to have children as many as the stars. Boom, he believed. Then goes from posterity to property. God makes him another promise. God gives him another vision. He wants to expand his hope, and he says, see all this land? I'm giving you this land. I'm giving you a prosperity, and I'm giving you the property for all of these children. Now, what does Abraham say now? How can I know this? Here's the pattern. God will speak to you, and he'll give you a blueprint. He'll give you hope. You take the second step, and you believe. Then God turns right around, and God wants to increase your capacity to receive. He goes right back to a blueprint, and he makes it bigger. God is always looking to increase you on the inside so he can increase you on the outside. God is always trying to bump us up to the next level. God says, here's how many children you're going to have. Abraham believed. God says, you're right with me. I'm going to give you a bunch of land. God's not talking 3 acres at a fishing stream. He's talking a good chunk of property. Abraham, the Bible doesn't say Abraham goes, I believe that too. No, Abraham says, how can I know for sure? So then what does God do? He introduces blood covenant. God's pattern. He gives you a picture. You choose to believe. He goes right back and he wants to expand your capacity to receive by expanding your hope, by expanding your blueprint. If we will spend time listening to God, he will keep our imagination busy. Here is the answer to the question, why is it, Phil, that it's so easy for me to believe God for this, but it's kind of difficult or even almost impossible for me to believe God for this? It's the same God who promised me this, that promised me that. I can believe this real easy. I'm struggling with that over there. The answer is twofold. One, you probably heard more about what's easier for you to believe. Number two, it's easier for you to see it. Through the eye of your imagination, through the power of hope, it's easier for you to see it. Therefore, it's easier for you to believe it. Something else God promised you, it's a little bit more difficult for you to see it, so therefore it's harder for you to believe it. Let's take these 10 steps and reduce them down to 3 things. In order for us to be successful at receiving from the Lord, living a life of faith, we have to have these 3 elements that we see in the life of Abraham. Abraham saw his faith, Abraham said his faith, and Abraham did his faith. He lived it out. Many of us are wanting to jump over to the saying when we haven't seen it yet. You need to see it. You need the power of hope. You get that down, it's easier to say it. It's easier to do it. People don't do what they don't see. Why are Christians failing at being a doer of the word? They don't see themselves being a doer of the word. They see themselves with all this junk, and we've had contamination of the imagination. We've had all these pictures thrown at us from an ungodly world that's contaminated our hope. And the Bible talks about an evil hope. And many Christians, unfortunately, have operated in an evil hope. Well, as opposed to from the outside in getting this contamination, our imagination should flow from the inside out through our spirit, by the Spirit, through the promises of God. As that happens from the inside out, we push out the contamination, we push out the junk, and we have a sanctification in the imagination, and we can see it clearer. So what is it that God's promised you that you can go, oh yeah, I can see that. And the same God's promised you something, and you're like, Well, now, I just don't know. Lord, I need something. Lord, how can I know that for sure? What's the answer? Run to the communion table. Run to your covenant meal. Spend time with the broken body, the shed blood of Jesus, and know that God's making covenant promises to you. And after you receive that one, he's going to say something else to you. God is just going to keep bumping it up, taking you to another level throughout your life. Hope, faith, and hope again. That's God's pattern. That's the pattern that God dealt with Abraham. That's the pattern that God deals with you and I. Now, there's two things about the nature of God. Pardon me. There's two things about the nature of faith that I think is crucial for us in understanding how Abraham took this second step. So I want to look at one just real quick, and then we'll pick it up Monday, because tomorrow we're going to pray for our partners and friends. In John 20, if you'll go to John 20, this is something about faith. And this is after the resurrection of Jesus. Here's something about the nature of faith. This is what, when Abraham was in hope, and he took the second step of believing, this is what happened. And we need to see the nature of faith. In John 20, 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. Faith is a decision. It's a choice. Somewhere on the inside of you, you have got to say, I choose this. I choose this promise. I believe this. I believe God said this to me, and I believe that this is true. You have to make a decision. You have to make a choice what you're going to believe. Thomas said, I will not believe. I have to see it. I have to feel it. And so Jesus appears to him and says, stop being faithless, Thomas. Blessed are those who believe who haven't seen. So we have to make a choice. Now, this becomes an area of battleground between you and the devil. You make the decision. I believe 1 Peter 2:24. I believe by his stripes I'm healed. And the devil says, oh yeah, we'll see about that one. And he turns up the volume on the pain in your body. The devil always challenges real faith. I believe my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. The devil says, oh yeah, we'll see about that. And the refrigerator breaks down and the kids get sick in 3 days. The battleground is the decision. Once the decision is made, the rest is fairly easy. But we have to make the choice. I am going to be a man of faith. I'm going to be a woman of faith. I'm a person of the covenant. I'm taking God at his word. And come hell or high water, this is my decision. I'm casting anchor, and this is what my I'm seeing only this. I see only this, and I'm getting busy with my imagination, building hope and increasing my faith by looking at what God said to me. It's a choice. Praise God. Brother William says, I choose to believe. Sister Lisa says, I choose to have faith. Thank you very much. And so it's a choice. But God will take you deeper with that choice. When he gives you a promise and you say, God, I choose to believe that, God's like, oh, good, we got something to work with. So God wants to eventually get you to the place where he says, here's what I really want from you, Sister Lisa. I want you to choose to live by faith. Jesus says, okay, Brother William, what I really want is I want you to choose to live by faith. Not just a this deal and a that deal and a deal over here, and maybe in 6 years we'll do another faith deal. No, we make a commitment. We make an unqualified committal of ourselves, and we abandon ourselves to God, just like Abraham. I am a man of faith. I choose to believe this. I'm a woman of faith. I'm a woman of the covenant, Lisa says. I choose this. And God says, now we've opened up the barn door wide. We can run with this. I'm looking for people that will make a decision. The Bible says, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. Behold, the day of the Lord is in the valley of decision. The day of the Lord is the day of God's power. Multitudes are in the valley of decision. God's just waiting for people to make a choice. And if they decide the word, decide to live by faith, then God's power backs up our choice. Praise God. Praise God. Father, I thank you for the people this morning. And I thank you that we've chosen to live by faith. We choose your word. We choose your promises. And we do believe, and the enemy's not going to steal our faith. We're taking this second step. We are going to live by faith. Father, we're a people of hope. We are a people of faith. We take the second step today. We are a person of faith. Amen. Amen. Monday, we'll pick it up. I want to look at another aspect of the nature of faith before we look at step three that Abraham took. Tomorrow, we get to pray for our partners and friends. And I've got a great announcement. We have been and we have felt your frustration with the quality of Sunday services. I've got good news. We've got some fresh equipment coming in, and we're hopefully going to have that up and running this Sunday. No promises, but it's supposed to arrive Saturday, and Brother Christian and I are going to be at the building setting up our new equipment, and we want Sunday's broadcast to be just as good of a quality, if not better, than the daily broadcast. So thank you for your prayers. We've spent a little bit of money. We're going to get Sunday's broadcast at a professional quality level, and you're going to like what's about to happen. Hallelujah. We love you so much. We'll see you tomorrow morning at 8 a.m.